by other microorganisms like the pesticide control. Because we use also a lot of pesticides to control the pests and also insecticides. We have a lot of insects. In summertime, there are lots of insects, they come out. And sometimes they start eating the plant. So we go and buy the insecticide product in the market.
That's inorganic.
Huh?
Inorganic.
They're all chemicals. Organic, inorganic, normally inorganic. They're not even good compounds, but they're very toxic. They're very toxic to human also. So we have to spray them. But if you use compost, the many insects, it is, works against many, many insects. Or make BT, for example. I will give a lecture, probably tomorrow, I will give a lecture on BT. So you can make BT in sludge, and then you can spray on your plants. So, under, okay, with compost, you feed it in the soil, with Trichoderma, and above you can spray BT in soil, in sludge. Because after sterilization, there's nothing. No pathogen, nothing, no problem. It's just organic matter. So this is very simple. Anyway, we'll talk about BT tomorrow, and we'll be able to see what we can do. It's one of the processes. So already start for me. You can wait for the question. Okay, the digestate, after a little digestion, that's a scheme, okay. Now, you see the lesson number 7 here. So in the number 7, after another week digestion, you are centrifuging, and what you are adding in the line is stabilization. This is nothing but digestate. Yeah, because the gases go up. After centrifuge, the water left, it is maybe very high VOD, so you return it to the people plant head. And this is digestate. So lime, you haul, and then composting, and then take it to the plant. So all these in the wherever the anaerobic digestion is, after this centrifuge, these are all digestate. The only difference is that okay, in anaerobic digestion it is much lesser than without digestion.
Based on quality, aerobic compost and anaerobic compost, how can we compare?
Okay, the quality has to be compared in terms of 3 items. Number 1 is the pathogen, number 2 the metals, number 3 are the CLGK, that's not like that. Same thing with the compost. So, when it has gone to under anaerobic digestion and lime stabilization, basically the population will be reduced to quite high level. But in case of only aerobic digestion, of course aerobic digestion has not been considered here because the as I said before, that new plants being constructed, they don't want to put in energy. Because aerobic digestion is nothing, just you have to put in energy. That's it, but nothing out of it. But you are putting in a lot of energy, so aerobic people don't want anymore. But certainly, anaerobic, these schemes, any of these schemes would be better than those aerobic digestion. And also, if the we have not discussed here about the pretreatment units, because this was specifically for that mountain sewers commission, and the commission did not want to put a plant on digestion. Oh, sorry, pretreatment. That's what they were very clear. This technology is very expensive, and 150,000 people could not bear the load, the financial load of that, because then they had to increase the tax. Okay, because anyway, when you put in something, so money has to come from somewhere. The government has no money. Government never gives any money. This is a municipality business, and their affairs, and they have to manage themselves. So then in that case, they have to increase some tax, okay, per household. Okay, like for the sludge treatment and wastewater treatment, they charge every household, I think, $2 per month, something like that. So $2 per month is not a big amount. It doesn't look like a big amount. But when there are so many collections every month, so there's a lot of money. But if they put a thermal treatment unit, which is, as we have seen, is the best one, then that means another cost probably $3-4 million. $3-4 million means they need that capital somewhere. So, and they to obtain the capital, they have to increase the tax. And if the tax they have to increase, then they have to go to the public for their first of all to talk to them. Oh, look here, we want to do this. Okay, so we increase that. These are the pros, these are the cons. We must do it. Otherwise, that something happened. There are all sorts of things. And in the public, you have to go to each community in the city, and then okay, say that of course some will be always yes or no. It's a question of vote, correct? And then okay, they judge the mood of the people, and based on the judging the mood of the people, they will increase the tax or decide not to vote. But the chairman at the time, of course, a good friend of mine, and they said no, we cannot go to the public because they just need to vote. So they said okay, just like that. And moreover, the compost, it was following all the norms. So there was no need to put extra money on insulator. And of course, on top of that, they did not opt for another regulation. They said our compost is working fine, so why we should go for anything else? They had all the reasons, and because all the analysis now was in front of them, on the table. So they could see very easily, oh, why if our compost is working so well, what is going on in the system? So, but if the capacity is high and the composts are not selling, then they have to find some way, that is a problem. Then they start looking for something else. But as far as the concern is for the quality, certainly another question of the compost will be a better quality than. My question was only was that, okay, install because they have to deal with it. There was a pain in the neck, right? So when you have pain in the neck, so you have to use some medicine. So the best medicine and the cheapest medicine for them, okay, construct the concrete tank, fill it up, pile it. It will reduce 40%, okay, good, so it's spend less. That's it. No consideration of GST, no consideration of energy.
But economically, it's which
okay,
one?
Okay, as I said, economically, if you see the economy, there is no economics here, it's a relative economics.
Yeah, that's what.
But nowadays, if more than economics, there's a consideration of climate change and the energy transition. That's nowadays the catchword. And if you have to catch this, so you have to show that your municipality is working better than anybody else, or at least you are not the worst. So you have to catch it.
Sir, but overall carbon concentration is remain as it is, but what we are doing...
No, carbon concentration does not remain as it is. In aerobic digestion, it flies over as CO2. Mm-hmm. In aerobic digestion, it flies over as methane and CO2.
But in aerobic digestion system, no? We are also producing CO2 and methane as a byproduct, and we further using this thing. If we don't produce that CO2 and methane, but in aerobic, we generally produce CO2 as much as compared to methane. So what we will do, we'll just take out the compost or treated sludge and pour in the soil or landfill. So the rate of carbon emission will be reduced.
We of course, if you go anyway, if you go to landfills, it is compulsory that either you treat it aerobically or anaerobically.
Yeah.
Okay. So in that case, that 40% will be stabilized. 30 to 40% will be stabilized. Then will be gone. And the rest of the material, okay, it will be difficult to degrade or slowly degrade or whatever is that. But when you fill in the landfill, there are so many activities that are going on.
Yeah.
So those activities over a period of time, they degrade much more than otherwise you could degrade in a reactor.
But what my question is that we applying that anaerobic digestion, something like that. So we are the rate of emission of methane and CO2 is increasing as compared to the aerobic digestion.
It's the methane which is culprit.
Yeah.
Because in aerobic digestion there is no methane formation. There is only
CO2.
Only CO2. So that's one gas. And another GHG is the electrical consumption. But here methane, which is how much? 21 times higher potential
than the carbon
than CO2. So therefore nobody wants to emit methane. And also on top of that, CO2 can be captured, okay, through other technologies or through plant growth or forest, whatever is that. But methane, unless you flare or what happens, is there for quite some time in the environment and causing all the chemicals.
One thing is like thing, because if we concern about CO2 emission or greenhouse emission, so like microbial activity in like ocean is one of the measures of CO2 sequestration. So majorly what we are doing or microbes we will do, like they were immobilized the CO2 and precipitate that calcite and other material and sequester in the form of calcite
carbonate underbenet
of like aragonite and calcite, something like that. So what they are temporarily immobilizing the carbon, and when out of sudden like global warming or something like that carbon will or methane will emit. So यहाँ तो हम लोग rapidly what we are doing उसको immobilize कर रहे हैं. If we are anaerobically we are treating this floods.
No, if you are treating anaerobically and if you are collecting the gas.
And further we are using as
and
a
you are using it for energy. Then you have energy gain.
So that
but if you are not using the gas and you are also not flaring, because once you flare, so the methane is oxidized to CO2. So the question is here that you put in less energy, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And the less energy input, as we have seen in the energy ratios.
Mm-hmm.
So basically the greenhouse gas effect is much lesser than if you fill somewhere and leave the methane gas to go to the environment. I wish his length is about this.
Yeah.
So basically somehow you have to end up this, look here, at the end of the day everything will turn into CO2.
CO2, exactly.
That's the same. Okay.
But
it's better that before it is, and then CO2 has zero energy because it is the most oxidized state. Correct. So, but methane is a reduced state. So wherever their carbon is in the form of energy giving, okay, so it's better that before it goes to CO2, you trap that energy and use it for something else. Use for something. So that is the whole story. So basically, it boils down to catch that energy. Anyway, ultimately, anything will go to CO2. That's the cycle. And then, of course, it comes the methods to trap the CO2. Like you mentioned, okay, C is the sink, and people think that, okay, you compress into C. And also, they are, like in Canada, they are looking for many holes, the mining pits or mining holes, where they can press the CO2, and they leave something there which turns into the carbonates. So many technologies are developing there, and of course they are effective. And then of course the enzyme is there, many enzymes are there. Nowadays they are trying to develop, enzymes are there, but they are trying to overproduce enzymes. Because that enzyme is produced, okay, which I don't remember the name, and that's turned the carbonates into carbon dioxide into carbon. But the problem is that it is a reverse process. It needs energy. Because CO2 is zero energy and carbonates have some energy because oxygen is there. So that energy is lowered when you use a certain enzymatic reactions. And people are developing those technologies. But here we are not developing that technology to capture carbon dioxide. We're trying to capture this carbon energy. before it may, anyway, as I said, at the end of the day, it is CO2. So before it becomes CO2, we just catch whatever we can catch.
So basically, we are triggering the mechanism of conversion of methane into CO2.
We are not triggering the reaction methane to CO2. Anyway, as I said, everything goes to it. But if you produce methane, then you can harness some energy. You are harnessing energy. Ultimately, methane is also burned to CO2.
Yeah.
You can also burn people, say that, fine, you don't need to do that. You dry the sludge and burn, and recover the energy like they do in insulation. But it's not that energy efficient process as the anaerobic digestion. Provided your ratio is now more than one, now you have invested for it.
Mm-hmm.
Because if it's less than one, that means you're using net energy, so why are you doing it?
We have discussed sludge pre-treatment, three methods extensively. One is like thermal pre-treatment and
ultrasound and
ultrasonic and phenton. So here we in phenton, we using H2O2. So maybe this chemical ultimately going to change the composition of sludge.
It does. That's why the biodegradability is increasing. It's doing something. Generally, it's oxidizing some material and it is also attacking some other material to hydrolyze this and then make it available to microbes.
So if we think about economically, like as compared to thermal decomposition, we generally but ultimately the major outcome of this all the process is two things. One is energy producing gases like methane and some other gases, and another one is like we are using the remaining sludge as a manure or fertilizer. So that phenton or H2O2 treatment will changing the ultimate comes out.
You mean the texture which you are going to apply?
Texture or MNP ratio of the manure.
Sorry, what ratio?
MNP.
NPK concentration in the manure. No, I don't think so. It will affect that much. No, it doesn't affect because everything is there and it's only what it does. Solubilizes matter is there. It's oxidized, but some matter is oxidized, but not to that level. It's very very. Compared to the total present, probably few percentage.
Not like heavy metal is, it will not get much oxidized or reduced, but like a phosphorus.
You do not add that much dose, but heavy metals will be oxidized.
Very
optimized dose so that only it affects your organic matter. Because if you add very high dose, then even your oxidized, your material will go to CO2, straightforward.
And required much higher temperature, but we are working on 187. But whatever.
No, 183 in terms of in the thermal pretreatment.
Yeah,
it's not in H2O2.
Yeah, but.
You're confusing here, or I am confused. There is some problem here. We are not on the same way, but.
So my question is like maybe it's changed in NPK composition. It's not.
H2O2 does not change. And even if it changes, it's not appreciated. No one understands. But the question is that this technology will not be applied.
Hmm.
As you have seen in the balance. And nobody uses it. No one uses it. But certainly people consider everybody has to run their business. We are researchers, so we keep on doing research. Probably we can find some better ways. But if somebody goes and asks money in Canada that I'm doing phenton treatment, or I'm doing this ultrasound treatment, give me a grant.
No.
Forget it. No way. You're outrightly receptive. Of course, they have to consider. Because you have all the right to apply and to say whatever you want to say and try to get money. But they are the experts. They will say, if I'm there on the time, I'll say, no. Forget about it. No, it's okay. Because as I said, I've been on many panels and they have been done some. Another thing is microwave treatment also. There is also like this. People try, microwave is good, very good, this, that, and it's good, of course, but the energy balance just has no way.
Ultimately, we are using energy.
But not only that, applying the microwave technology at a higher scale, this is not for some time, so it's not going to work. It doesn't matter. again, the best example in my current plant, I had that, I got that, I told this morning that I bought that $30,000 ultrasound unit, continuous treatment. For my, it was for, not for sludge, but it was, yeah, it was for sludge because sludge contained plastics. And then you want to break the sludge to release the plastic. It didn't work. But if you take the small in my lab, ultrasound, okay, you put under the horn, it be in a beaker, it works fine. Even it attacks the lignocellulosic material which is there in the sludge, and it makes the solution brown because the lignin is dissolved. And the cells are broken and plastic is released. But when you have a continuous system, it fails. So that's my experience. General experience is that the technology cannot be applied in functions. And these are all, you know, small wastewater. Just think of the big wastewater. If you have, I don't know how many are there, how big are they? When it's dealing with such a huge population. Because yesterday, day before yesterday, you told me, it was yesterday, right? You day before, when we were there. So you told me that, oh, there are many, many plants like this. Nobody there, it's only one plant.
Mm-hmm.
Like in Montreal, we have $3.5 million, there's only one plant.
One plant.
You don't construct many plants. Because otherwise you have to spend a lot of money. You know, the economy of scale, I hope you know what is the economy of scale. The larger is the thing, the lower is the price, or lower is the cost. So why to create a 100 treatment plant in Dubai?
One treatment plant selling high.
Yeah, in Dubai also, we are 800,000, 900,000 people, just one plant. So they collect the water at one place, and then only thing is that, okay, the primary treatment unit is separate because they want to remove their this primary sludge, mm-hmm. because otherwise, it makes problem pumping that whole material.
Mm-hmm.
So they have only at the central plant the primary treatment, and the another locality has that. So that they collect that from that locality and they do the primary treatment, and for the secondary treatment, they send the central plant. This is because, sometimes geographical situations like that, up and down, down, up, so then it costs you more, or you spend more energy, and you have a higher capacity pump to pump that viscous material. So all civil engineering and chemical engineering, everything is there. Works together.
Yeah, I have one question. Like it,
even asking, no problem. I'm here. You have 4:30.
It's not
official time.
It's not related to this lecture today.
You can ask any general thing in this world. Okay,
like
it's not that. You just ask me only what I talked today. You can ask me whatever I talked so far. You can ask me out of that also.
Yes, sir.
Whatever I know, I will tell you. Whatever I don't know, I will say no.
So, after secondary treatment, then water will go for supply and or tertiary treatment. It depend upon your construction plant. So, in tertiary treatment, they are using like charcoal or UV treatment of water or something like that. So, how much time retention time is sufficient? So, water will pass through the UV, so it will be get disintegrated.
Okay, it depends on your gateway system. Gateway system mean, let's say how many bulbs you have put in a line.
Yeah.
Correct? Because when the water goes out, so it doesn't flow in pipes, it flow in channels.
Channel.
Okay, which are not very deep. Okay? And those UV bulbs are placed at the bottom. Correct? And then they throw the UV from the bottom, and they have to make sure that in a certain height that the UV reaches the last point. And it does the job which for it is constructed. So basically, I will say in a couple of minutes, 3 or 4 minutes.
So water should be retained, or it will be continuous
it's
in flow.
No, okay. Yes. Now you calculate your flow rate. You remember that how to calculate HRT?
Yeah.
Okay, V by F. V in volume. F is the
flow rate.
Okay. And then you calculate. Okay, if you need the 3 minutes residence time or 4 minutes residence time, to see how much length you require, because you already have the height. That becomes your reactor now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's a cubical reactor now. Height is less, width is large, and then you can say width or whatever is the length, and then you calculate this through which it pass, and that will give you the resistance time. Same formula. So depending on their own experience, because every municipality, also wastewater treatment plant also can leave a different load of pathogens. So they test it, and by the virtue of their experience, they decide and then they fix it. But once they fix it, it's fixed. They cannot change it. If they change, you change it. It's not something every day. It can cost you very much. Correct?
Yeah.
Or if you look, you can go and walk on it. Other facility, yeah. You have that. So people go and see, and the visitors go and see that. Because it's a normal municipality, so you can also go and see that. You take an appointment and you go, oh, and you visit. Okay, fine, you will be very happy. Because that's how also they convince the people or the community that they are doing good job for them. Here, as you said, people told me nobody wants to even talk because they will lose their secret, right? If they are not treating, but no, it's completely worse there. Because they are producing food, and people are paying for that. So if something happens, that people, if there are people here and cry, immediately something will happen without them. Well controlled to that, and well regulated society. And everybody feels they are okay, responsible. They say, I pay the tax, this is my money, so this should be put to the use. Why does it go to in some hands which are not using it correctly? It's your money, when you pay tax, it's your money, it's your government. That's the feeling. No, it's completely different mindset. Completely different mindset. Silent spectators. चलिए मदन लाल जी आप कुछ क्वेश्चन करेंगे
सर इन एरोबिक सिस्टम इन सीरीज ऑफ रिएक्टर्स एरोबिक एंड ऑक्सीजन एंड एरोबिक सिस्टम सो हाउ एफिशिएंट इट
इज गुड पॉइंट वेरी गुड पॉइंट I'm trying to remember where is this diagram in my I should have somewhere. Let me check, okay, because I want to explain you the diagram. I can explain you with probably the other people can also understand it over the other system. Let's try to see if I have that reactor. I'm not sure if you are aware of that, what the question she is asking is related to the sequencing batch reactor. Okay, I think most of you know. Okay. So basically, what are the stages of treatment? Okay, so if you the diagram, okay. So basically, you have a reactor, so you have a fill mold. Okay. In the fill mold, there is a mixing and aeration both together. And what happens that those microorganisms are already present. So they react immediately and they start utilizing the carbon source. But what happens, okay, because when you are filling that, during the filling, the oxygen concentration is low. So denitrify, and the substrate comes, denitrifiers are there. So whatever is returned from the IGL stays to that. Nitrogen, the first of all, it is denitrified. Whatever nitrates are left, number one, denitrification occurs, and all these nitrates are denitrified, whatever is left in the IGL mode. Because I told that also earlier that denitrifiers, they grow slowly, and by the time they reach everything there, by mixing aeration in the last time in the ideal stage, everything is consumed. So they cannot work, but they are there, right? So as soon as they get a chance, they are in the film mode, they do the job. So that's the job. Number two, that go to the reactor stage, and in the reactor stage, the mixing aeration, so the heterotrophs that again start growing at a high speed, and they start degrading the organic matter, and also using the nitrogen as usual in an aerobic process, okay, like an activity process. And then it goes to the settling mode. Settling mode means, okay, it goes down, settles easily, and the oxygen concentration decreases, and when oxygen concentration decreases, So the, again, if some subset is left, so dehumidifiers probably have been less consumption today. But this diagram is for another purpose, and I will come back to it later on what the purpose is that. And then it goes to after that settling mode, so okay, the beacon mode, and then okay, they treat, this is the treated water, they remove, and then it goes there, and then they sludge, the concentrated sludge. Okay? So here these are just the beacon, and beacon settle the same thing, okay, just after beacons. And that's why they put the two stages here, they remove. Okay? And then okay, they mess the sludge, and it goes there. So this way, what is the advantages here is that okay, the nitrogen is denitrified, and all the nitrates in the first mode. Okay, so the denitrifiers, they get enough time to react and to convert all the residual nitrate here and whatever the nitrate comes in. So the nitrate concentration is very low here because you are taking down this. That's a sequencing batch reactor. Sequencing batch reactor basically is, I don't know if you know that, this is to remove phosphorus. That's called the enhanced biological phosphorus removal. How many of you are like, familiar with that? None of you.
Only we have just heard the term.
Huh?
We have just listened to heard it. But we don't know much about it.
Okay. So basically, the sequencing batch reactors are operated for enhanced biological system, for biological phosphorus removal. Of course, in Canada, we do not have any BPR because our wastewaters are not rich in phosphorus. But yeah, in the States, there's so many. But here, you have very rich phosphorus. I'm more than sure that you must have very rich wastewater. Okay, so you have that. Now, what happens basically? During aeration mode, that's the reactor, the react mode, it consumes all the phosphorus. Okay? It consumes all the phosphorus, and it degrades the stored compound at the same time. Okay. When it goes to the settling mode, basically it throws away the phosphorus because the oxygen depleted, the anoxic zone occurred. So it basically throws out the phosphorus. And then there is another stage here, it goes there, the next one, okay. What we call the ideal stage, so in this case we use the ideal stage there, and then it will throw away the phosphorus, and then again you aerate. And when you again aerate, so basically then the uptake again goes up. And that uptake is normally 1.2 to 1.3 times higher than it put out the phosphorus. So basically, so the microorganism, they have the extra carrying capacity, and then they accumulate the 20 to 30% higher phosphorus. But this does not happen overnight, so if you operate, they keep on operating the reactor, microorganism will be acclimatized. Or, in other words, those not the EVPR microorganism, they will be washed out of the system, and the EVPR will be consumed eventually. And after some time, it will start working in a steady state, so-called steady state. Of course, there is no perfect steady state, but assumingly, steady state. So that's what the sequencing batch reactor is. Basically, sequencing batch reactor is to remove extra nitrogen and to remove extra phosphorus.
So,
it's
equivalent ratio.
Equivalent ratio is everywhere. Okay, equivalent ratio is everywhere because if the nitrogen is not enough, then you may have the residual COD also. But if you have, normally there is no problem of nitrogen in wastewater treatment. If you are talking about the municipality, there is excess nitrogen, and that's why we call the nitrification and denitrification. Because if there is not enough nitrogen, like the best example is the pulp and paper wastewater. There they have to add the nitrogen, but they add only the nitrogen sufficient for the microbial growth. So there is no need there. It's only the municipal wastewater which always have excess nitrogen. And you cannot control CYN ratio in wastewater. You can probably control CYN ratio if you are doing your anaerobic digestion for your, like some substrate which you are adding or something like, so you mix with high nitrogen content and low nitrogen content. But I don't think so anybody adds nitrogen. So the problem is the reverse here. You have to remove the nitrogen, rather than you add nitrogen to the system. If you add nitrogen, then the other system. This is not the system. SBR is not the system.
Sir, nitrogen to denitrification process se remove hoga lekin phosphorus to sir ke liye wo usko kaise matlab nikla kahan sir wo to ghumta rahega ke second
na nahi ghumega kaise cell mein nikal jayega na wo ek step aur hota hai usme ye ek step kam hai na ye kisi aur purpose ke liye hai diagram us purpose ke liye nahi hai wo jab aayega bataunga kis purpose ke liye hai so lekin ye hai na ye jo tum sludge nikal rahe ho wo tane kaha ek bar ideal stage jayegi fermentation karoge to usme phosphorus aa jayega 1.2 times aur fir wo kya hoga wahan se jahan waste ja rahi hai wo usko uske sath chala jayega वो तो सज में है ना सज में आ गया हाँ तो सज में आ गया तो वो सज चला जाएगा और जो बाकी माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिज्म वो फिर से ग्रो करना शुरू करेंगे फिर वो ऊपर जाएंगे फिर उन्हें खाने को मिलेगा फिर अपना वो मौज करेंगे और उसके बाद फिर और बढ़ाएंगे धीरे तो फिर वो साइकिल चलता जाएगा आई एम सॉरी आई एम स्पीकिंग रूडिमेंट्री लैंग्वेज बट मदन लाल जी आप मुझे फोर्स ना कर रहे आई थिंक इज क्लियर टू एवरीबॉडी व्हाट आई सेड जस्ट नाउ
सर मेरा एक क्वेश्चन है
आप दस पूछ रहे
हैं सर ये मतलब अभी तक जो हम लोगों ने देखा कि जैसे हम लोग के लैब में वो जो भी सीनियर एक मतलब सबमिट किए सर उनका था क्या कि ऑर्गेनिक जो कंटामिनेंट्स थे आफ्टर ट्रीटमेंट वो स्लज में भी मिले और वेस्ट वाटर में भी मिले जो कि थ्रू आउट परसिस्ट कर रहे थे और वो भी ठीक ठाक अमाउंट तो सर उसके लिए कैसे मतलब आप लोग टेक केयर करते होंगे अपने एक्जेक्टली परसिस्टेंट ऑर्गेनिक आइदर इट मे बी फार्मास्यूटिकल और पेस्टिसाइड और ऑर्गेनोक्लोरीन व्हाटएवर इट मे बी बट दे परसिस्ट फॉर लॉन्ग टाइम एंड दे आर इन कंटीन्यूअसली ट्रीटेड इन ट्रीटेड वाटर आल्सो दे आर प्रेजेंट इन ट्रीटेड आल्सो
ओके सो फार टू माय बेस्ट ऑफ नॉलेज दे पीपल आर स्टडीइंग देयर फेट व्हाट इज हैपनिंग
Exactly.
Because there is no technology right now, so that you can say authentically this technology removes this compound. Because there are n number of compounds.
Because I am concerned about this because the water which we just treat, it also goes for irrigation and for other purposes, and also the sludge. We are also utilizing sludge in one or other way to the field, or which will ultimately reach to food chain. But we are not taking care of that thing
because we don't.
Exactly, but
we are not taking actually, you are absolutely right, we are not taking care because we really don't know. There is no knowledge about it. And that's why there is a lot of research is going on this particular aspect. To understand how they are entering,
exactly.
What is their fate in their treatment process, in activity process,
and also
what is their, how much they are on the slash, and what are they for, what happens further when they go to soil. So there are a lot of research is going on. But so far, I can say that there is no technology available authentically which can trace them and say, okay, fine, I do this. Yes, it's a matter of research.
Because
that's why they cannot put any rules, regulations. There are no regulations. Why? Because nobody knows.
Because this type of persistent contaminants, contaminants when they will persist in the field condition, they will ultimately. Follow the food chain pathway and they will further buy
food. No, not necessarily. That's where exactly we don't know. They may also be degraded in soil before they contaminate the food chain. Because if you contaminate the food chain, they will accumulate in the plants. Those studies are also being conducted. They are on the way.
So what about
probably a couple of years from now, we'll have the answers to all these questions. But today, I'll keep silent. Yeah, please.
I was just asking, what about the non-biodegradable things like PCPPs? I just read that nowadays PCPPs are increasing very much in the.
But why they are increasing? We are reducing them. We have reduced them to almost zero level. There's no the government disallowed to use the PCP because we know that it is dangerous.
So PCPPs, the products in pharmaceutical.
So PCBs, right?
Pharmaceutical companies. Mein, जो होता है
वो जो क्रिटिकल कंपनी होता है ना उनको गवर्नमेंट कह रही है अपना वेस्ट ट्रीट करो केमिकल्स
ओके
सो दैट्स व्हाई द इंडस्ट्रीज आर टोल्ड लाइक ओके यू यूज इलेक्ट्रिकल ट्रांसफार्मर्स यू हैव लॉट ऑफ पीसीबीज देयर राइट इन टर्म्स ऑफ किलो बट दे आर सपोज्ड टू ट्रीट ओके दे हैव टू गेट इट एंड देन ओके ट्रीट इट केमिकली ऑक्सीडाइज बिकॉज़ दैट्स अदरवाइज देयर इज नो आंसर टू And that is not in small quantity, that's in very large quantity. Because in the past, that's how they were contaminating the soil. Wherever their operation was, they were contaminating their soil. And the government has spent a lot of money to clean up, what they cleaned up those soils. And the same technology, okay, they did nothing, but they just enhanced certain fungi and bacteria in the soil. In the pile, they collected the pile, just like compost systems, and they aerated this, and the compounds were degraded. But that's a contaminant, that's a containment, right? But wastewater is not a containment, okay, it's flowing continuously. So, yeah, there's a lot of research is going on. But I'll give you an example, okay, we are one of my PhD students treating the wastewater, and the hospital wastewater, and we are observing that.
But sir, it might be possible, no? Just whenever there is treatment plant, and when the country, in your locality, the norms are so strict and the regulations are so hard, so they can just, for the point of monitoring also, they can just do something to just monitor the treated effluent. Is there any?
They can.
Exactly.
They're not doing.
They should, because...
They should. I also agree with you, they should. But until unless they're forced. I should know that, what they should monitor.
Because at least they will come to know what, which compound is persistent throughout. And actually these compounds also varies with season wise. So they can get a broader picture, and this will definitely give some positive
outcome
to the society as well.
No, you're absolutely right. But okay, as I said before, yes, that's what is basically the situation, unfortunately. Nobody's monitoring.
Because we can't...
Nobody's monitoring because there is no demand to monitor. And there is no demand because the knowledge is incomplete. Because all those strategic policy makers, to make a policy, they're okay, fine. What to monitor? What are the compounds to monitor? They don't know.
That's why, like
PCB or PCBs or maybe some other compounds probably. You can name the few, but what about the others? And like, for example, dioxin, you don't find it. PCB, you don't find it. They are controlling. Because this, see how you can control. Where you have to go and track the source. You see, you don't throw PCB. If she doesn't throw PCB, I don't throw. So where are you coming from? Some industry.
Sir, here is the case. Here is the case. That's why I want to discuss this thing. Because if they will monitor, if they will be in the process of continuous monitoring, so that they might segregate the level of contaminants. They might segregate the contaminants, and on the basis of the contaminant sectorization, they can identify that which type of industry or which type of process will is enhancing this type of organic waste generation.
No, the industries are already pinpointed. Okay, all industries have been pinpointed, not here, but in that part of the world. Everybody knows who is who. Okay, we know, like in Quebec City, the municipality knows who is who. Okay, what are the companies, where are they, what they can do, what they can discharge, okay. And they have been asked, like for example, even in my plant, I do not discharge any toxic contaminants. But before I throw it, I to make sure that there is nothing living organism in it. So similarly, all those industries which are producing those toxic chemicals or using those toxic chemicals, or there is a danger that they may contribute it to, they have been asked very strictly that you have to control at your place. Do not drop anything in the single line. And they do not do it.
Actually,
therefore, whatever the compounds are coming into the wastewater, they are coming basically from hospitals. Or the antibiotics or whatever the compound you are using in your household.
And
for that, the research is going on. Today, we don't know exactly for the reason of making the rules that, okay, we can create a rule on certain things, we have sufficient information. If the sufficient information will be there, then immediately there will be a rule.
And it will come.
So that's where we're stuck. That's where we are stuck. As I told you last time, that we observed, okay, in Burlington Harbor, Burlington is a place near Niagara Falls, if you ever heard that place, very world famous place for its fall, one of the, highest falls in the world. Near that is the harbor, and they found, they first noted sometime in late 90s that the fish were changing their sex. They were become non-reproductive. And then they found out, oh, what is happening? Because fishery is a big industry in Canada.
Mm.
They eat a lot of fish, okay? But not fish like here, okay? It's different. I don't know about it. So, I'm sorry. And then they said, oh, what is happening? And then they found that there's a contaminant also in fish. And that was the eye-opener. And then we started doing research and to find out where is what.
Reverse process.
But
yeah. They will, because of equestrians.
You see, the necessity is the mother of invention. Correct? That's how we say that. So we feel that, oh, there's something wrong somewhere. So how do we answer that? And that's what the whole, okay, not whole, at least all those 50 or 60 or 70% of the shit experts are working on that.
You see, that's equestrians that they do all
that. But that day is not, I don't see any nearby that the rules will be made very, very soon. And you cannot make any rule until unless you know everything for the 100%. You know, then of course there are so many examples. People used to say that, okay, you don't eat cholesterol, otherwise you have danger of heart attack. Correct? So they immediately, okay, came out with so many things, so many instructions to the populations, instructions on the bottle everywhere, okay, it contains so much of cholesterol, don't eat, you'll have heart attack. Whatever is that. Like you see on cigarettes, okay, cigarette is injurious to health, don't smoke. Okay, but very recently they found, no, cholesterol is not effective, it doesn't matter if you have intake of cholesterol. So overnight, everybody wiped out that instruction. So it's basically the research which is happening and trying to prove. But in this case, unfortunately, there is no conclusive research that to make the regulations. But I'm more than sure the day it will be, there are these international agencies working. That's their job basically, United States Environmental Protection Agency, Environment Canada. We have a Department of Environment in every province. So it's their job and they are looking into very, very seriously. They are not sitting back. But until unless the scientific community give them this, they can do nothing. Yes, but this is very good topic and you must do some research on that and come up with some kind of okay solutions in this. At least what you can do as a professor, as a researcher, that at least find out where do they exist in the wastewater and how much do they exist, and at least can inform the scientific community and the community that, okay, there's a danger here, these compounds are there, and of course, that's how it started. Yeah, that's how it started. That I give you the best example.
Hmm.
Yeah, chali, aur chali aage.
Ek
nahi aata usko.
So, you talked about incineration is a problem. Incineration also plays a role, matlab ki some country use incineration process to control the sludge. But
yes.
To dispose, sir. But somewhere I just read that incineration process, we are just doing it with positive intention. But somehow.
Why? What do you mean positive intention?
मतलब sir, dioxins वगैरह भी निकलते हैं जो क्या कि unintentionally, क्योंकि हमारा तो purpose नहीं होता
है
dioxins.
Because unburned carbon है वहाँ पर. Exactly.
We are just decreasing the load, sludge load. But a lot of dioxin tax compounds are
throwing
in the flue gases.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
So uske liye to that's why the people are worried. The people don't want to do incineration. That's why they want to go for these technologies, the biological technologies. And nowadays also those that technology has been defined. When you incinerate, okay, so the flue gases, mm-hmm. they control in the flue gases, they extract it, they pass through the solution and they try to extract all the compounds and all the volatile compounds, including the metals. Because there are metals also, whichever products. They are trying to control it, and that's where they also extract heat. But to what level? That's a question again. Because what compounds they are trying to control? Dioxin, PCBs, what else? It can be anything.
Because
the question is that these compounds list is so heavy, so large, and there is no research on all compounds. The research is only on those compounds which really exists in high level. But what else? What about the others? It's unlike metals. Metals, you know how many metals. Okay? You can pinpoint those metals. Their number. But organic compounds, unlimited. So mostly they take antibiotics at the hospital. And then they take, okay, what we are using in the community as an industrial product. where is used what, and then they go with that. But down the line, something else is formed also. You see that? Okay, if you're talking about dioxin, it goes through that wastewater plant, and it will degrade, or something else will be there. How do you know that?
That's why monitoring is important.
So, people are doing, they are measuring entomotoxicity. Sorry, toxicity, not entomotoxicity.
Toxicity.
People are measuring toxicity, and they are measuring the genetic characters. They are the ways to do that, right? How many yeasts they got genetically defected or changed. So they are doing that. And then what are those compounds? Now you identify those compounds. You have the identification tools. We recently, LC-MS-MS has come up, and there are quadruple attached to it, to LC-MS-MS. But are we sure that we can detect all the compounds and all the daughter products? You know about the parental product, but what are the daughter products? How many are they? Don't know. How can you detect? That's a big challenge. It's not that people are sitting quiet. Lots of money is being spent. Lots of work is going on throughout this world. But to make the rules, we don't have sufficient knowledge. And if the knowledge is there, then the people are just waiting. Who makes the rules? We make the rules. If I don't know, who knows? If you don't know, who knows? They are just sitting there. They are not scientists like me and you. You tell them, or we tell them, okay, no, this should be this. Okay, fine. They will start promulgating and see everybody follows. These are very, very, very big issues nowadays. And, we have to wait and see what happens.
Concentration will high, then we can able to detect that.
No, it's not a question of concentration high or low. First of all, you have to identify the compound. You don't know what compound is that. Okay, as I said, okay, you start with some antibiotic or some toxins are made. You go through the atelectasis process, the biological process, it degrades the parent compound, it forms daughter compound, it's more toxic.
More toxic. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So now you go measure the toxicity. You see that, okay, it's high toxicity than the before. Mm-hmm. But how do you detect this compound which is giving this toxicity? The analytical tools are limited also. I don't know if you have LC-MS
here. LC-MS we have. Yeah.
But it is only dedicated to protein facility.
Yeah, with the library and the quadruple.
No, not quadruple.
Normal
LC-MS. Normal
LC-MS.
So I mean, these are the two. Not everybody has oxygen. And then they are also limited.
Very less quantity of that. And that HRGCMS we are trying.
This is a burning.
HRGCMS. It's only two equipments are in India, one in Meering and other in the CPC. And both are not working.
HRGC.
It's not working. Both are. So now we are trying that it should come to JNCS. Yes, I am trying for SCS. Hello, Kishok. Are you glad? Come with me.
Another unrelated question, sir. How do you measure the emissions in terms of equivalent carbon dioxide?
How do you measure what?
Emissions, like...
Equivalent of carbon dioxide?
Yeah.
Oh, that we gave that, okay, equivalent, okay. That,
yeah, so this
methane is 21 times and that is...
How do you measure emissions from, say, a grid chamber in terms of...
Right, okay, very good, okay. So grid chamber is okay, normally it moves in it, it's a flow system, okay. So there can be, how do you take them out? So there is the electrical grid removes and throw it away. You have to take it out, you have to do some kind of operations there to haul it to somewhere, whatever the grids are there, so that's energy consumption. We know that grids are just grid, passes through the bars,
right?
It passes through the bars, okay, liquid is flowing,
yeah.
But then there is a lot of material that is stick onto the bar, so you have to remove it. You cannot leave it there, correct?
Yeah.
That will cost some energy. Even the human factor is there, what will cost some energy. And then there are, of course, the automatic remover of those grids,
mm-hmm.
Which take out and. Oh my god. Have you seen anything in the grid chamber?
Yes, sir.
This is immense. Right? Water flows such a high speed and there's so much grid, the thick bars there. So that's energy. Energy can be in any form. Of course, you do not
count the work load, but you count the any electricity or any energy spent. But that should be a very small part in comparison to other factors. Chaliye, aage chalte hain.
It's okay if you don't have question, then okay, today's session is over.
नहीं ये लोग धीरे धीरे सोच सोच के पूछते हैं
तो ठीक है
मैं बैठे रहते हैं सोचते हैं फिर कुछ आते हैं बाहर मतलब उनको बाहर निकालना बड़ा मुश्किल है उनको बहुत पंप करना पड़ता है तब ये मैं क्वेश्चन लिए सब बैठे मुझे मालूम है लेकिन पता नहीं इनको क्यों खींच रहती
है I can ask you one
question
concentration of carbon dioxide is higher in comparison to other greenhouse gases how people are thinking the more threat from the nitrous oxide and nitrogen in fact What is your opinion? Because source production in the nitrous oxide and concentration of nitrogen in the field, agriculture field and all, the major nitrous oxide sources is the field, agriculture field. I have somebody, in fact, I have seen that from the Universal University Biotechnology Department, they were saying, claiming that nitrogen is going to be a major threat for the, particularly for the Indian scenario.
No, I don't think so. It's only the Indian scenario. It's anywhere where the agriculture is fertilizer intense.
300 times greenhouse potential.
No. When the IPCC made these regulations, it is the same story for the talks about it. Not many data. And then, country-wise, they just fix a value. Depending based on their experience, that this much nitrogen is there, so this much probably goes to the engineer. Okay? Mm-hmm. But now people are doing research. And they are coming out with the data, most recent data, that no, it's not one, it's higher production. I remember last time I was in an IWA conference, and the paper was presented on that, exactly on that, that how much time nitrogen N2O is produced, then it might be possible.
Yeah, both things is important. The production and already the global warming potential is more. So this means that 300 times more.
Exactly.
But the how much production is also important.
So that's what they are measuring now. And that's what the research is going on.
I think that in Indian scenario, I don't know, we don't have the reliable data again.
Yeah,
global
exactly.
Global warming gases is concerned.
That's what it's like.
Similar to the, you can say, the PO pops and the dioxide like that. We don't have any data.
Even case of stress, they take some value, approximate, relatively, as well as well. Which varies from country to country.
Definitely. Indian government, they have to answer, in fact, before 31st of December 2016, to the international body, about the POPs and DIOPs. They have to. They are not the signatories of POPs and DIOPs, but they have adopted it. And the NERI is the center. And their job is to find out in Indian's conditions, not only in India, but Southeast Asia. They have taken the assignment, NERI, but they have not done anything. And they have the HRGCMS, but HRGCMS is not working. So that is the Japanese opinion. The Japanese JICA people decided they came to our school. They are interested to provide the HRGCMS to them. Maybe in university, or maybe I buy a school, or maybe I will take up this assignment again.
Yes, it's a very good research to do.
Yeah, I'm thinking that if nobody will come forward, I will take this assignment. POPs lab, I will make. Okay then, thank you. We will meet tomorrow again. I thank Ben.